Growing up in a small, predominantly Christian, town, I spent a lot of my formative years deeply involved in the church. My diurnal rhythms always centered around God. Wake up in the morning, give thanks. Eating a meal, say a blessing. Going to bed on my knees, hands steepled, nightly prayers. Sunday school, Bible study, fundraisers. The path seemed so clear. When it is all you have ever really known, you don't think to question it. At least I didn't until I met my wife, Catherine, in college. Catherine was in my theosophy class, and it was her challenging questions and opinions that really made me notice her. Complementing her keen intellect with long dark hair, like coffee with an infinitesimal dash of cream, a rich brown hue that had hints of auburn undertones when the light hit it just right, and stunning green eyes, a shade that reminded me of maple leaves in spring, I found my gaze drifting to her seat more and more each day. Her presence a magnet I could not resist. She thrived on debating subjects most people would simply become too angry or emotional to discuss with a level head. Not Cat, as I came to call her. She was uniquely well adjusted to remain unbiased, keeping her slate clean, so to speak. Every person was entitled to their own beliefs, she would say, I just want to understand why they have them in the first place. By our junior year, it was obvious to me I would propose to Kat. They say you just know when you have met your soulmate, kismet, fate. We were like two sides to the same coin, yin and yang. Our differences added dimension to our relationship, a depth. She was never pushy about meeting my parents despite the fact I had already met hers. I had been putting it off for a while, for several reasons, but if I was going to pop the question, then it was inevitable. It was time to meet the family. Despite my warnings about how religious they were, I think Kat thought I was exaggerating. I wasn't. The meeting went about as well as you can imagine, which means it was a catastrophe. I also learned a lot about my family during that visit, how rigid their beliefs were. It was eye-opening, to say the least. After we graduated, we got married in a small ceremony. And if I spent less time praying, it was just a gradual evolution, I suppose. Maybe the exposure to such a free thinker had worn off on me. Little did I know God doesn't like playing second fiddle. Our house was a fixer-upper, a fancy way of saying all we could afford. It wasn't a total dung heap, but it definitely was a house only broke newlyweds could love. So, when the house suddenly swarmed with locusts in the middle of winter, we were completely blindsided by it. The pest control man seemed just as perplexed. We laughed at the absurdity and dismissed it as a random act of nature. When the gnats came and we called the pest control man, again, we started to wonder if the real estate agent had forgotten to disclose everything concerning the house. Kat called, of course, and the realtor sent the inspection papers over, and clear as day, it was a clean bill of health. The man sprayed and we paid. Mystery left unsolved. It wasn't until I came downstairs the next morning, groggy and still half asleep, that I felt a little on edge, a squiggly unease that twisted my stomach in proper sailor knots. I rubbed my eyes, gave my arm a painful little pinch, and still my sight showed me an impossible vision. Every surface, the kitchen counters, the fridge, even the toaster, had layer upon layer of frogs on them. It was like they had been hiding down here all night, perfectly staged for a horrifying reveal. Waiting for an audience before commencing their macabre concert. As soon as I made eye contact with a frog the size of two fists pushed together, the swell noise alone almost pushed me off my feet. I was just so damn flabbergasted. I knew my Bible stories well, drilled until I could recite whole passages, and this seemed unnervingly reminiscent of the plagues of Egypt. I had never heard of God stalking people, that was usually reserved for hauntings and possession, dark and most decidedly demonic. I was so lost in thought I didn't hear Kat's soft steps enter the kitchen. It was her gasp of surprise that ruptured my train of thought. We called animal control this time and waited for him on the porch in disheveled pajamas. The noise inside was deafening. Have you ever heard a thousand frogs ribbit at the same time? It doesn't even sound like a frog anymore, it's just this wave of undulating noise that buffets you like hurricane force winds. They gave the Tibetan monks a run for their money. While we waited, I shared my suspicions, needing to say it aloud because honestly I was afraid. To Kat's credit, she didn't laugh or dismiss it. That wasn't to say she shared my opinion, just that she was a good sounding board for hypotheticals and ideas. To allay my fears, she gave solid, scientific reasoning, and I had to admit that sounded a lot more realistic than God throwing a temper tantrum. Because in my head I was already thinking, if he can do this, what might he do if he was really angry? The only way to know for sure was to conduct a little controlled experiment. I hadn't prayed in earnest for months, I was too busy loving my new bride and fixing little projects around the house. With the green light from Kat, that night I prayed. And wouldn't you know it, we woke up to a normal house. No blights out of season, no freak accidents of nature. The following night I didn't pray, worshipping Kat's body instead. That next morning, we had blood pouring from every faucet, every spigot, not rust-colored water blood. The CDC was called, for lack of knowing who else to inform, and they came, muttered amongst themselves, and took samples. The tests came back inconclusive, yet the one deciding factor they were absolutely sure of was that it was blood. Every single blood type and some they couldn't identify. The Bible is peppered with cautionary tales, but they are usually implied allegorically. Good versus evil, right versus wrong. The age-old dichotomy of opposing forces. I had never felt afraid of God until that moment. It weighed heavily on my shoulders. The need to protect Kat while trying to be true to myself in the process. The very fact that he would send plagues to beset me made wanting to pray to him abhorrent. No one should feel like they have to pay tribute to God to live a peaceful life. That night I refused to pray, to give in. Kat, my steady rock, was there to support me through and through. I had terrible dreams, a nightmare that stretched out before me like a purgatory, only it wasn't the devil who glowered from his throne on high. I woke in a cold sweat, trembling with fear. Horrible images felt seared in my mind like they had been branded. Pulsing like dying embers. The one thing that kept circulating in my head, what I couldn't figure out was why me? In a world of billions, let that sink in for a minute, billions, he seemed entirely preoccupied with my faith in particular. Or lack thereof, to be politically correct. For some reason my thoughts kept drifting back to my parents. Scrutinizing their reaction when they met Kat. Had I mistaken hostility for fear? Kat still peacefully slept, so I slipped out of the covers and padded barefoot out of our bedroom, closing the door behind me. Two things were on my immediate agenda: coffee, copious amounts of caffeine, and a phone call home. It was my mother who answered, and I cut through pleasantries like a boat carves the sea. Broaching the difficult subject, I expected defensive posturing, maybe even adamant refusal. I did not anticipate the weary sigh and shaky response I got instead. "Do you know why so few people leave our town?" my mother asked me. I replied in the negative, "Honestly, I never really thought about it. Because the world is full of temptation, forbidden knowledge, and God likes his flock to remain ignorant. I had hoped you would be the exception, that maybe he wouldn't notice one sheep when he still had a herd shackled to the altar. But you wouldn't be calling if that were case. You know the feeling of falling, how your stomach seems to rise up, threatening to block your airways." Hearing my mother speak so caustically, so full of bitter resignation, escalated my panic to new heights. I couldn't stop my hands from shaking, so I sat on them. "All you can do is pray and hope he moves his all-seeing eye elsewhere. I love you, I have to go." The dial tone made sure to remind me of the disconnected call. Sitting in stunned silence, I watched the sun rise through the kitchen window. Beautiful in its simplicity. Then I pictured God with a giant easel and the peaceful moment soured then curdled. Cat trudged in behind me, nuzzling my back affectionately. I poured her a cup of coffee, adding a refill to my own mug, and shared what my mother had said. Cat blew on her mug. She preferred her coffee black to my heavy cream and copious sugar and seemed to mull over my words. We had already established the very real cause and effect of my daily devotionals. Cat lit up suddenly like she had a eureka moment. "Okay, hear me out. If the devil and God are supposed to be equal forces and by proxy equal adversaries, haven't people for millennium fashioned totems or artifacts, what is the word, warding symbols? You know, for like protection and stuff. So, if there are ways to shield yourself from the devil," she let the conclusion be left unsaid. "Then there has to be a way to shield yourself from God," I answered dutifully. "I mean, it's a theory, but it sounds plausible, right?" she said with a wink. I kissed her sweet lips and smiled. I nodded and grabbed my laptop from the soon-to-be study. "Internet, don't fail me now." There was precious little concerning my predicament. Most of the available resources could be put in two distinct categories: people writing pieces with the sole intention of being ironic and funny, or it was deep occult stuff, which to me looked an awful lot like devil worshipping. I found a few chat rooms, religious and whatnot, and tried my luck there only to end in a resounding failure. Fanatics hounding me, begging to meet God as if I had him on speed dial. I also felt certain no sympathies would be forthcoming from the clergy of my faith. Which posed the question, how far was I willing to go? 4 days I struggled with that question. My entire upbringing was based on religion, its daily practice and constitutions. I had no qualms letting that go, especially after what had happened. But was it a fundamental blunder in thinking the devil would be any less duplicitous? Fear rolled over like unused minutes, pressing down on my shoulders. Every minute I was waiting for the next blow. Sleeping in short bursts. I felt like I was losing my mind. Meanwhile, Kat did her best to comfort me, being the rock of the relationship when I felt absolutely untethered, adrift. It was a radical shift, faith bearing real fruit. Knowing and then knowing with cold certainty that the God you used to think above human pettiness is perhaps the pettiest of all. How far was I willing to go? Kat finding out she was pregnant made the decision for me. I was willing to go as far as necessary to keep her safe. It was the fable of Pandora that gave me the idea. I immersed myself in Enochian magic, in sacred geometry. I researched until my eyes were bloodshot how the old gods were imprisoned. The sigils and runes that acted as a barrier. Not stopping there, I ventured into suppository folklore, gleaning the fragments of truth from the retellings. Because if God did exist, then so did monsters. I put my blood, sweat, and tears into that trap, meticulously checking that each symbol was perfect. Kat helped with the overall design and construction. And together we crafted our very own God box. Tricking him to get in the box was an adventure in itself, almost costing me my right arm. At first, he shook and bellowed, and Kat and I feared it wouldn't hold, but eventually he calmed down. Make no mistake, he is probably seething, plotting all the ways to kill and maim me. But Kat and I make sure to reapply the seals daily. So if you're wondering why your prayers go unanswered, sorry, but trust me, it's better if they don't. Subscribe to the channel not to miss new stories.